understand, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you,
sir. Thank you, sir. Now, Sharif from Vijayanagaram. Sharif from Vijayanagaram.
Sharif?
Sharif, sir. Yes, Sharif.
Please repeat. Like
yes, Sharif.
Sharif, Sharif. Sheikh Sharif, Vijayanagaram.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sir, unmute ki chance chano. Sir, please unmute. Sharif, sir. Please unmute.
Is there, Sharif, sir?
Yes, sir, he is there. Sharif, sir.
Good evening, yeah. Sir. Ramazi.
Good evening.
My question is, please explain about frames of reference.
Oh, that will be a lecture.
To explain what are the main difference between the inertial frame of reference and the non-inertial frame?
It will take a lecture, but essentially your frames of references are put XYZ axis, fixed point called origin, and fixed three lines XYZ axis, and use these three lines to say that this is the position of a particle. Give XYZ coordinates with reference to your chosen lines and say that, okay, this is the position, right? So that is how you define velocity, you define acceleration, and whatever things you define. Now, if you have chosen a certain kind of frames, then the Newton's first law is valid. If you don't apply any force, you don't see any acceleration. Such frames are called inertial frames. And if you choose a frame in which it doesn't happen like that, you don't apply any force, the resultant force is zero, but still you have an acceleration, then this is non-inertial. So basically, this is a difference. And then if you want details, it will take time.
Sir, there is a small confusion. Sir.
Yeah.
According to the definition of frames of reference, the inertial frame of reference and non-inertial frame of reference, inertial frame of reference, those frame of reference are obeys the Newton laws.
First law.
If not, non-inertial frame of reference.
Correct.
So, what are the main, sir? There is a confusion. Obey means, Newton laws obeys means?
Very simple. In fact, you think of your own laboratory, your own house. Okay? Sir. When you drop something, it accelerates down. Correct. But when you hold it in your hand, the weight is balanced by the force by your hand, the resultant is zero. The resultant is zero and the resultant acceleration is also zero. So Newton's law is obeyed, right? But now if you are in a freely falling state, when you are jumping, okay, when you are jumping, you are in air. So, in that frame, if you put your frame there, if you put your origin at your hand and the XYZ axis in your body, which itself is moving, so your axes are also moving. In that frame, if you see, there is a force by the gravity. There is a force by the gravity and not balanced by anything. And still you have acceleration. So, Newton's law is not obeyed. Okay, or if never try this, but suppose you are in a freely falling cabin, and in that cabin you have put XYZ axis, and you just drop something from your pocket and don't hold it, and you see that the position is not changing with respect to this frame, so it is at rest. But the force of gravity is still there. So the force is there, there is no acceleration. The Newton's laws are not obeyed. There is no inertial frame. Okay. So obeyed and not obeyed are possible.
Okay, thanks so much, sir. Next, Purnima Jatpeches Murupaka from Srikakulam district. Purnima. Jatpeches Murupaka from Srikakulam district.
Purnima.
Please. Nara.
yeah. Purnima Singitam kada.
Yeah.
Purnima, I have given you to unmute.
Please unmute and ask your question, Purnima.
Okay, sir. Sir, namaste.
Namaste.
Actually, in pictures and other videos, some green screen and blue screens are used to remove the background.
Okay.
And that is a pixels formed according to the background. Okay. And that chroma key is used. Are there any relation between these chroma keys and photoelectric effect?
I do not know. You can write your question to me. I will find this answer from the experts and mail to you.
Why the only two screens are used here to remove the background?
Yeah, you write your question in a mail, and I will find the answer from the experts and mail back to you.
Okay. Actually,
presently, I do not know.
Actually, it is any difficult question or any other?
No, nothing is difficult in this world. All right, if you are ready to put in effort, put in time, then nothing is difficult. We can always find ways to solve our problems.
Actually, I am using this chroma key, sir, and using this green screen and blue screen. Right. Then I am using other color. It is giving some blurred image.
Yeah.
Green and
I also use those green screens for doing this chroma thing.
Yeah.
I also do this, but I have not thought about it. That why only that green thing works. But you write to me and I'll find the answer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Now, Ishar Rao from AP Model School. Ishar Rao.
Ishar Rao Dandi.
Yes, he raised the hand.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Ishar Rao Dandi.
Yeah, I have given.
Ishar, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I am big fan of you, sir.
Everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Everybody. Yeah.
I'm lucky.
Sir, my question is about tensors, sir. Tensors and precision anti-gravity.
Precision anti-gravity, what?
When you press a certain rotations, like I saw recently one video, sir. They can float in air with about anti-gravity. How is it possible? And also confused about angular momentum is a tensor and momentum of inertia tensor. Some confused about tensors concept. I read out something, but I confused about the tensors. That is my question.
Tensor is a totally different issue. There's certain angular momentum or moment of inertia, those things are related through tensor quantities. So that one that I know, but I cannot tell you what it is here. And the other thing that you are saying, that in gravity you can float something in air or in space. For that, the full context is needed. It's not very difficult answer, but full context is needed. All right. So this isolated sentence will not be enough to answer the question. So if you tell me in what context that whole thing is there, then probably I can help. And the tensor quantity in rotational mechanics, dynamics, basically you come across moment of inertia tensor. Angular momentum is a vector. And then torque is a vector. But then torque and angular momentum, if you try to connect them, they are to be connected through moment of inertia tensor. Normally in our school colleges, in schools in fact, we talk of moment of inertia about a line. Okay. But the moment of inertia is essentially a quantity which is defined about a point. Okay. And then where you try to define moment of inertia about a point, x, y, z axis are needed. All three axes are needed. Right? Three lines are needed. Then you have nine varieties of moment of inertia about that point, nine components about that point. So if you combine x and y, you get one component, y and z one component, so on so on. So out of these nine, some are equal to each other, and so on so forth.
Yes.
And then about a line is a very special case. Out of those 9 components, 3 components are about the 3 axes, about x axis, about y axis, about z axis, as we understand, as we do in schools, about a line, about x axis, about y axis, about z axis, those 3. But then there are 6 more. Of course, 3 which are then equal, but we write it separately. X and y, y and x, that we write separately. Then it becomes 6, otherwise 3. So you have something, some other kind of definition. There you had the distance squared. Here you do not have distance squared. You have product of x coordinate and y coordinate. Summation of that. Multiply by mass, summation of that. Those kind of. Now those things are to be involved if you want to connect angular velocity and angular momentum. L equal to I omega will not work. L equal to I omega will not work. Torque is equal to I alpha will not work unless you take all those 6 components also into picture. In very simplistic cases, those 6 components are not needed. And then our school algebra is fit. Basically, that's the qualitative answer.
Thank you, sir. Now, Harita Kumari from Vijayanagaram. Harita Kumari from Vijayanagaram.
Harita.
Yeah, Nena. Harita ma'am, please unmute. Okay, ma'am. Sir, she is.
Namaste, sir. Namaskar, Andy.
Namaste, Harita.
Namaste. I have a question about fluorescence and phosphorescence. And recently, we are observing some optical illusions. Buddha picture is there, with dot on his nose. And if we observe that dot for certain seconds, 30 seconds, around like that. And after that, if you watch some wall, white wall or something like that, because of retention or optical illusion, what we can see that particular kind of image. What is there behind that particular consequence? I didn't understand. Could you please explain?
I think it will need longer explanation. So I would prefer if you give me some time and space to talk about at length. So maybe you write to me once again and I look at it. I know that. That image retention and color retention and all those things. But
one more question. Can I ask, sir?
Yeah, please.
Often we discuss about centripetal force and centrifugal force. Centripetal force is a real force which is provided by some certain agent whenever an object is in a circular path by different agents like a gravitational force or electrostatic force or tension in the spring or something like that. But we talk about centrifugal force as a virtual force. While teaching, while discussing about this particular concept, often children are asking, virtual force means what does it mean? That means, is it not there? Or suppose if this centripetal force suddenly ceases out, this object it is moving away from the path, circular path, out of its path. Then how can we explain about this particular virtual force, centrifugal force?
It's closely related to that inertial and non-inertial range of references. Okay, you can start with some example. Let us say sun-earth system. That will be a good example. Don't put that string in between. So sun and earth will be a good example to talk about this. And you say that if we draw a line from sun to earth and take that as the x-axis, okay, and let the x-axis rotate, because it's my x-axis is always from the sun to the earth. So if earth rotates, x-axis also rotates. And perpendicular to x-axis, y-axis, so that also rotates. So I'm using xy-axis, which are rotating themselves. Earth is rotating is one thing, and my axis are rotating, that's another thing. Now, if I use that as the x-axis and y-axis, my earth is not moving. It's all the time at the same coordinate, right? Its x coordinate is fixed, y coordinate is zero, z coordinate is zero. So this is completely at rest. Okay. Similarly, you can say that we can have, let's say, a disk, rotating disk, big rotating disk, and I'm sitting at the center. I'm sitting in the center on that rotating disk. Okay. And then my face is also rotating. I'm also rotating, but I am at the center. Now I am looking at something. Let's say same spring, stones, whatever. So if that is also rotating, to me it is not rotating. Okay? Because I'm also turning my head, I'm also turning my eyes. So as this stone is rotating, it's always in front of my eyes. I will say for me it's not rotating. So these are the cases, examples where we are using rotating frame of reference, and in that XYZ axis, the thing is not rotating. That my object is not rotating, and therefore it is at rest. Okay. Now I'm still fond of Newton's law, that Earth's the Sun's attraction is very much there, but Earth is not moving. The Earth is at rest in my frame of reference. In my X, Y, Z axis chosen, I have chosen X axis from the sun to the earth, and that will remain my X axis. Wherever earth go, my X axis will also go. So if I'm using that, then the dilemma is that there is a force of attraction by the sun on the earth, which is towards the center, and still the earth is not moving. And there we say that, okay, although I am not using the proper frame, that's the fault. But that can be covered by saying that there is another force, which is centrifugal force, which is towards outside, which is equal in magnitude to this GM M1 M2 by R square. And therefore, the total resultant is zero. And therefore, the Earth is at rest in my frame. Okay. So to save Newton's law, or to say that since we are comfortable with Newton's law, we know how to use Newton's law, so we do not want to go it away from our hands. And for that, we have to use some force which is not there. And still we have to use it. Then only the Newton's law will be applicable. That is why it is called a virtual force. It is not there. Very true. It's not there. But if I am using... if I am using lab frame, if my X, Y, Z axes are not rotating, and I say that my stone is rotating, or if I say that Earth is rotating, then absolutely no need of centrifugal force. There is a force towards the center. There is an acceleration towards the center. F equal to MF, perfect.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now Rajendra Prasad Garu, sir, he is a headmaster and a DCB secretary, who is full support of our physical science forum, sir. Now Rajendra Prasad Garu, please interact with Swarmaji, sir.
Sir, good evening, great evening, sir, today.
Thank you.
You are a passion personified.
Oh, thank you very much.
Without your books, the libraries in our schools are not complete.
Uh-huh.
You're always a point of reference to each and every doubt and each every complex point.
Yeah,
and my question is general in nature from the administrative point of view.
Okay.
Would you please throw some light on the ways through which physical science can be made a passion for the among the students? We are looking forward to an inspiring guidelines.
Right. In fact, you are already doing that in a very nice manner, and I only can think of two ways. One is that our nature is very beautiful. The laws of nature are even more beautiful, and attempt to discover or find or understand those nature laws are even more beautiful. So if that can be inculcated, if that appreciation to the world, if we can instill this culture of appreciating everything, if there's a fire, then we appreciate how that that radiation is coming, how that fire is coming, how it is giving us warmth. If we are we have put our wet clothes in the sun, and then in an hour it becomes dry. It's such a common thing. But if you can really appreciate that why this is happening, this is happening because the water molecules are in continuous motion. If they are not in continuous motion inside that cloth, then why should they go out of the cloth? They should remain there all the time. So since they are moving with such a random speeds here and there and there and there, and the sun gives a little more extra energy to some of them, and all of them not coming out at a time. It takes an hour to dry that cloth. Why? Why not in 1 minute? Why not in 1 second? So only some of these molecules are able to come out, taking that extra energy from the sun. And that cosmic dance is going on. All the molecules are going here, there, there. They are making coalesces. That is behind drying my clothes. If I can appreciate common things in this fashion, then naturally I'll be after it. Okay. So that is one thing. Second thing is stories. Second thing is story. If you include some inspiring stories about science and scientists, that will also help. And of course, the third thing is your hands-on activities. And then you show them that, okay, this is how things happen, right? And of course, if you are in a little more advanced stage, then applications. So the science has done wonders. So those kind of things, perhaps one can try.
Thank you, sir. I have a lot of doubts because of I am slow learner.
No, it's wrong. Wait. Before your question, let me make a comment. Doubts come only to people who try to think more.
Yeah, sir. Okay.
So if there are a lot of doubts, you are thinking, and that's very good.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, I am silly question. So my question is, does an atom have a color?
Pardon?
Does an atom have a color?
Ah, okay. Yeah, it's a very good question, in fact. And for that, one should understand what color means. Okay, where is the color? If I am wearing a colorful shirt, and one says that this is red, this is green, this is blue, so on, right? But these are threads. They do not have colors. These have atoms.
Threads.
The molecules. Light, we say there are 7 colors in light. Light is electric field and magnetic field. Where are colors? Electric field doesn't have a color. Magnetic field doesn't have a color. Light is electromagnetic wave. Light doesn't have any color. Okay. If the wavelength is there, it only means that, okay, after this much of distance, the electric fields will be the same. Where is color coming into picture? If the wavelength is 400 nanometer or 500 nanometer or 700 nanometer, where is the color coming into picture? It only says that after this much of distance, the electric field value will be repeated. Where is the color? Color is only in our brain. Color is only in our brain when light enters our eyes. When light enters our eyes, then different wavelengths of light will have different energies of photons, and they fall on our retina. And at retina, these energies are converted into electrical voltages. No color. These are electrical voltages which are sent from the eye to the brain through the optical nerves. And these voltages reach our brain and we see colors. So it is an electronic processing of electrical signals. And our brain tells us that, okay, this is green and this is blue. So materials do not have any color. Now, coming to your question. If it is a single atom, then there's nothing which can tell that this will absorb the other colors and to really reflect the green or this and that. It will not be there. For that, you need a bunch of molecules, a lot of molecules. And that interaction, that molecular vibration, that interactions between the crystal structure, all those things will decide which wavelengths to be absorbed and which wavelengths to be reflected. And that will tell that when this light goes into your eyes, what kind of color perception the brain will create. Okay, so single atom will even not have that role to absorb partially certain wavelengths and reflect partially something. And then if it is one by one, one photon by one photon interaction, your eye will not be able to see anything about it. Okay.
So, thank you very much, sir. We are ending the question answer session. Thank you, sir. And sir, this event was jointly organized by our Srikakulam Andhra Pradesh Physical Science Teachers Forum, Srikakulam district, and my native place Vijayanagaram district. Both the teacher forums are jointly organized in association with our Anveshka and IAPT RC11. So I'm very much thankful to you, sir, for giving this opportunity for all of us. And my teacher, Dr. S. Sanyas Raju, who is the senior most lecturer from North Andhra Pradesh, is very, from the beginning, he is completely supervising or directing or everything, sir. He wants to talk with you. Sir Sanyas Raju, sir, please. Sir Sanyas Raj, sir, please unmute yourself.
So thank you, Chandrasekhar. And very good evening.
Good evening. Namaste.
Yeah, it is really very nice and a good experience for me, not only for me, for all the participants to interact with you. And I may say the character of S.C. Varmagaru in my physics principle. And thanks. We know that work can be converted into energy.
Yes.
And energy can be converted into work. So I used to wonder how Varma Sahab used to get that much of energy.
Yes, sir. All your blessings, sir.
The physics principle by doing work. So naturally, maybe he is doing, I think, nearly 10 to 12 hours a day working on physics, and that work will give him a lot of energy, and that energy he is imparting to our students, and it is really a wonderful experience for all of us to have a personality like you to interact with our teachers, and we will be remembered forever for your contribution to IAPT, to NANI, to other Anveshika, like that number of programs are going on. So I hope that some of our students are getting a lot of knowledge about interacting with you, and definitely it will go a long way in imparting their knowledge to their students. And I will just conclude with one quotation of Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan, sir. Acquiring and imparting knowledge are to be like two eyes for a teacher. acquiring and imparting.
Yeah.
We should acquire knowledge. Yeah. That knowledge should be transferred to the students. And that's what Karma Sahab is doing for the last 40 to 50 years. And really, I'm thankful for him to come over and participate in this program. Thank you, sir.
Nowadays, all the experimental work is completely depends on our H.C. Varmaji sir only.
Yeah.
He is inspiring. He is inspiring all of us.
Yeah. Yourself, Srinivas, and a number of our teachers are definitely getting a lot of knowledge and information from him. And that you should pass on to your students so that that process will continue forever. Thank you, sir.